braved a Sunday afternoon to be here, assuming there will be something worthy of your time. It is my privilege to be able to receive this, but to be honest with you, these awards don't mean much to me. It used to, but now they don't mean much to me because I know this is not my award. This belongs to the institution that I represent. And with all humility, I accept this on behalf of IIM Calicut, which is much bigger than any director would be, because an institution is always greater than the individual who is supposed to serve this institution. I thought this afternoon to make this worthwhile and meaningful for you, I'll share some of my concerns about education. The first concern is this education that we provide to the university systems is at least 150 years behind time. You know, this is a product of the industrial age. If you look at what is the driving logic of the industrial age depended on centralization of systems. There would be a factory where goods would be produced, and the factory would be divided in, would be organized into separate sections. And movement of goods and services will move from a central place to the periphery. And if you look at our institutions, not just universities and education institutions, if you look at our parliament, if you look at our media, if you look at the judiciary, it's the same old story. You can commit a crime today, you can slap somebody on the street of Calicut, and after 10 years, you might get a verdict. So it is very safe to slap somebody, because justice will take 10 years to be delivered. You can provide an education in the department and there is no guarantee the person who's passing out of the department will get jobs. Doesn't matter. So the industrial system is based on the logic of the scarce. It is based on the logic of centralization. If you look at what is happening outside the university system in the real world, see, the industrial system puts university in ghetto subject silos, and learning is mediated by a period. It's a 60 minutes, 70 minutes, 90 minutes, whatever the period is. Now see how it goes against all kinds of logic. What kind of logic? The logic is that learning does not happen as a function of time. Learning happens because of the brain state of the learner. Learning happens at the level of the learner, not as a function of time. But we have reduced learning to a time period, right? If you cannot pass an exam in 2 years, you are unqualified, you are disqualified, right? And then sometimes you say, if you get 75% marks, you get 75% marks, then you are considered having passed with some distinction, right? Now this is like saying, you can have a car with 3 wheels. And with 3 wheels, the car would be nice. So if you have not learned something fully, you still pass with distinction. Now, having not learned something fully, you can apply that learning in the real world and you'll see what happens in the real world. That's why PhDs of universities are working as clerks. IIM and IIT graduates working as salespeople. Your highest institutions are producing job seekers. Alright? Largely unemployable. They can't create jobs, they're looking for jobs, right? And so the problem of the system is that it is way behind schedule. It is, there's no change that happens here because all changes will depend on people who are incumbent in the system. We'll have to rethink whether or not, and as our Vice Chancellor said very clearly, whether or not we are providing real value, whether students are learning what they're supposed to learn. And this then becomes an important question. Are you ready to listen? If you're not ready to listen, Honorable Member of Parliament, can I have your attention, sir? If you're not listening, then I can't talk. Thank you. So I'm asking you to ponder over a problem where our Parliament, our judiciary, our education system are going through the same archaic system that does not work, that does not function. The second problem with the education system is that in this information age, you don't really want to go to university. University has to come to you. Why? For $100 today, you can get a Harvard MIT lesson sitting at your doorstep. You don't have to go to an IIM or Calicut University. Interesting, right? Interesting. That the university will come to you because you have access, you have information, you have technology. University will come to you, to your doorstep. You can decide, 50 years down the line, you can decide what kind of degree you will have. You can, you know, at Harvard, at the education school, a student can decide what subjects combination will compose his or her. He can compose, like a cook composes raw material for food. You can decide what subjects you want to learn. And the university has to provide, because the university will be competing with other places. It's not going to be a monopoly anymore, unless the governments still believe that monopoly is the way to go. I don't think the governments can really contain the movement that we are seeing. Problem three is the kind of rapid changes that are happening in the job market. The top five employers in the world today did not exist 10 years back. Top five employers in the world today did not exist 10 years back. So you cannot predict what kind of jobs your people will get. As it is, they are not getting jobs commensurate to their qualification. So this is so, then the only value of learning in the education system would be not so much of content, it will be teaching students how to learn, how to continue to learn. You see, we had the entire parliament of the Kerala government who had come to our campus, you are aware of that. And the extraordinary thing is that these parliamentarians were in the learning mode. They had paid 25,000 rupees to come to the campus. You know, even the finance minister very graciously accepted that he should pay the fine if the cell phones went off. So we didn't allow anybody to disturb, we didn't allow policemen, we didn't allow secretaries, because we were in a learning institution. And I think it is time. Honourable Member of Parliament, I can't speak unless you're hearing. Sir, I can't speak unless you're hearing. You have to listen, otherwise I can't talk. So what we're saying is it possible? Is it possible that learning becomes the job of everyone, including people in the government, people who are incumbent in the government? Today I have got a note from the Chief Minister of Kerala, and it's going to happen in the Planning Commission as well. Now, the cabinet is saying we want IIM graduates to come and work as research fellows with each of our cabinet ministers. We have given them a proposal, and the proposal is that employ our graduates for 2 years. They will do your research. They will do your research. They will tell you what your constituency really needs. They will give you data about what are some of the challenges in your constituency. And for this, you have to kind of employ the best minds of India. And so I think there is a debate going on. I hope that the cabinet approves this. So what we are saying is that the rapid changes that are happening in the scene out there, even for political parties to stay in power, political parties have to understand how the next generation is thinking. And so learning becomes institutionalized. Learning becomes a problem of all institutions. All institutions. Because we hardly know. Sitting in IIM, I hardly know. I take in only 300 odd students out of 200,000 applications. I don't know what is this more than 200,000 students, what are they doing? What are they looking for? I don't know. So I have to know, and for that I need to learn. I have to increase my pace of learning. At IIM Kozhikode, we have looked at a course called Perspective Course. You know, believe me, for instance, the education department here is teaching a course called Education. And 32 faculty from different departments are coming to teach that one course. So you have a perspective course, which 32 of my faculty teach. And what is a perspective course? The perspective course is about how money has to be earned, how money has to be shared, and how money has to be stored. You know, this is the course. And it's an interesting thing that 32 faculty, when they come and teach the course, it's a different kind of learning. It's a different kind of learning. The excitement in the classroom is very different. We are talking about blended learning, where the computer and the teacher will come together. There are some things that the computer can do much better. know, data processing, giving facts. You don't really need a teacher to remember all of this. But you do need a teacher to hold hands of the learner. You need a teacher to create the governance structure for running a classroom. You need a teacher to inspire. A computer cannot inspire. You see this? And so it is very important that you have to understand the computer and the human being have to come together. It's not an either-or phenomena. We are looking at then fundamentally three axioms of education. I'm going to conclude with three axioms on education. The first axiom is, and something this is something that you might want to remember, if it is worth it, nothing has been taught until it is learned. You know, I heard a conversation about the other day about George Bush and Dr. Manmohan Singh talk in a quiz competition. It's a joke, please take this as a joke. Don't take it too seriously, all right? But it's a useful joke to learn about or learn from. So the quiz person is saying, suppose your parents gave birth to a child, your mother gave birth to a child, and the child is neither your brother nor your sister. What is your relationship with the child? And we know Dr. Manmohan Singh is a smart gentleman. He ponders for a while. George Bush could not answer the question, and Dr. Manmohan Singh said, that's me. And George Bush was impressed. He went back to America. And while he was in America, he wanted to test his own people. So he asked his Secretary of State, tell me, your mother gives birth to a child who is neither your sister nor your brother. What is your relationship? The Secretary of State said, sir, I'll have to think of it a little bit. I'll get back to you. So she goes to Colin Powell, who is supposed to be the smartest. So Colin Powell, because he's smart, he says, oh, my mother gives birth to a child, neither my brother nor my sister, that's me. So the Secretary of State goes back to George Bush and says, sir, I've found the answer. George Bush says, what is the answer? He said, the answer is Colin Powell. George Bush said, you know, I have to dismiss you. I can't keep you here. You can't get the right answer. You're the Secretary of State of America. He said, sir, but I gave you the right answer. It is Colin Powell. No, it is not Colin Powell. It is Dr. Manmohan Singh. You see, this is the nature of learning. Can you see what's happening here? Nothing has been taught until it is learned. So, you have students like George Bush. You have students like this in many places, including the parliament, right? So you have students like George Bush, and it's very difficult to assess the learning until the student certifies that, you know, I have learned. So learning has to be self-paced. We are looking at technology that can, you know, you have a technology now where you, after playing football, you can finish the homework because, you know, technology is enabling you to create a classroom in your backyard. You don't have to come to a classroom like this to learn at your own pace. So you have to learn this. The second axiom of learning is you have to teach what is near before you can teach people what is far. Now, if you're teaching history, you have to teach the history of Calicut. IIMK has just got a museum in place. It's called the Museum of Indian Business History. We had a person called Dr. Noon who actually delivered a phenomenal good talk. How many people know that two wars were fought in Calicut? How many people know that this was the first modern city of India? How many people know that it is here that the destiny of India was shaped in 1498 in a way we didn't understand it? So our museum puts together something that's very near, something that's close to the sun. So a teacher of history has to tell you local history. He has to tell you the history of the building right there, the history of the soil. See, geography teacher has to tell you what is the climate here. And then you can learn something very far. See, you have to learn about your local context before you talk about global things. Third axiom and the final axiom of learning is education is about connecting the part to the whole. You know, that's what a university means. University means universal. You have to connect the part to the whole. You know, what is the whole and what is the part? The distinction is, the part is about what you can see. The part is about what you can know with your senses. The whole is about what you can know plus what you cannot know. What you don't know, that is the whole. So if the part is only a part, then your knowledge is partial. You shouldn't be in the university system. So you have to know how the part in education fits in with literature, how literature fits in with sciences. No? Somebody knows calculus, but if you knew calculus along with physics, you learn physics much better. You know, a lot of people who learn chemistry, for them organic chemistry is a real challenge. But if you learn inorganic chemistry while connected to organic chemistry, then you can understand the whole system. Now, I have a distinctive word for it, and the whole is called source. What is the source? Source. And part is the resource. Gandhi is the source. Anna Hazare is the resource. Okay? Spring water is source. Bottled water is resource. This is spring water is source. Bottled water is resource. The spring, the season called spring, is the source. A flower is the resource. A plant is a resource. You can cut off all the plants, all the flowers, but you cannot prevent the spring from coming. Alright? So you have to be the whole. And that's the job of the education system, that's the job of the university. With these few words, and with my deep gratitude that you've decided that I am worthy, on behalf of my institution, to receive this award. Your beloved Vice Chancellor, we spent some time together. I came here only because of him, because I know you'll be here. And you'd feel offended if I did not come. So in all humility, I would say that, you know, there are not many people and very worthy awardees here sitting on stage, and the ones who are giving the award have done a great job in encouraging. And I'm sure somebody sitting here will one day occupy the space that I am occupying and do a job better than I have done. Thank you so much.
Let me invite the Honorable Member of Parliament, C.T. Mohammed Bashir sir, to do the official inaugural address of the National Education Summit. C.T. Mohammed Bashir is the chairman of the Chamber of Education in New Delhi and the former Education Minister of Government of Kerala.
Most respected Dr. Meera, HOD, Department of Education, who is presiding over this function. Our honorable and dynamic Vice Chancellor of this university, Sri Salam. Other eminent academicians and my dear friends, give me immense pleasure to be with you in participating in this very important discussion pertaining to the challenges of the education sector, which is organized jointly by the University of Calicut and the Chamber of Education, headed by me, actually. Even the scholars are going to speak before you, and I don't want to take much of your time. As correctly pointed out by Professor Chatterjee, we all should be lifelong learners, including politicians. I agree with you. I hope that this kind of seminars will really enrich our knowledge. It gives us ample opportunity to have interaction on the problem pertaining to the education sector.